Songs to sing, 165.
For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, His blood availed for me. Hear Him, ye deaf, His praise, ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy.
Amen. Amen. All right, I think it's 186. I hope so here. Yes, 186. It's just like His great love. Amen. It's just like His great love. Okay, let's see here.
A friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true, and never fails however 'tis tried, no matter what I do. I've sinned against this love of His, but when I knelt to I cannot see my just like Jesus all along the way. It's just like His great love. Oh, I could sing forever.
Time of year, I guess each year there's a annual chili cook-off down on the commons, and they shut off both ends of the commons, the streets. I think it might be Cuga Street and Aurora Street, yeah. So at the east and west end of the commons, and they set up little booths, you know, of different vendors selling you know, their chili. So you buy tickets and you can go to these different stations and get a little cup of chili. So there's a lot of people milling around. The most people I've seen on the commons, certainly in the wintertime. So So I was able to hand out tracts at different places. I just kind of keep moving as, you know, the crowds came and that kind of thing. And so, you know, I had an opportunity to talk to some people about the Lord and share the gospel with them, and met some Christians as well. And later in the day, there was a big crowd out in front of what used to be Plums. I don't know if that's what street that is. Cayuga Street on the east side? Or is that Aurora Street? Anyway.
Help him out there, Ryan.
Anyway.
Aurora's on the east.
Aurora. So, so I just kind of came upon that scene. I felt the Lord's leading me to preach. And so there were, you know, hundreds probably of people. And there was a spot right in the middle of the street. Or not in the middle of the street, but on the side with a snowbank. So I just climbed up on top of the snowbank and looking down over the crowd. And so started preaching. And, you know, so people turned and, you know, were listening and could see some people take out their iPhones and they're recording it. And so it's, you know, anytime you preach God's word, it's a pretty unique and special event, and if you ever want to scatter a crowd, that's a way to do it, because people, you know, started to, you know, there was a crowd out in front of, I don't know what it is now, but they started to go down to the other vendors over time as I was preaching. But, you know, people just did stay and were listening, you know, for a period of time. So I just praise the Lord for those opportunities that He gives and how He leads that, you know, to put, you know, a snowbank there that I can stand on with a light pole behind me. And so after I preached a while, a fellow walked up and he said, "Is that your little mount that you're giving a sermon from the mount on?" So I thought that was cute, because I never know what I'm going to hear from somebody that comes up to me. So that was cute. This morning I'll be reading from Galatians chapter 5. Verses 13 through 26. So if you'd stand with me, and we'll honor God's word this morning, as they did in the Old Testament days. So Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 through 26, God's word says, "For, brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Amen." Now if you bow with me for a word of prayer. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and once again, Lord, want to thank you for the opportunity to gather together before thee and to worship you in spirit and in truth. And we thank you, Lord, for the fellow believers in Jesus Christ that are here today. And we thank you, Lord, for thy word, that this reading of thy word, that every word there, Lord, is true. And we thank you, Lord, for the clarity of thy word, that there's people in the world today were born as sinners, and Lord, and it's only through thy grace that comes through faith in Jesus Christ that one is saved and spared, Lord, from eternal punishment in hell for these different things that were read this morning. And we thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit that comes to each believer in Christ. And Lord, we look forward to hearing more about your word this morning through the pastor. And I pray, Lord, for the anointing of thy Holy Spirit upon pastor this morning as he preaches the message you have for us. And I pray, Lord, for our ears and hearts to be open to thy word. And we invite you now, Lord, to come in and take over this service, that you may be glorified and magnified in every way. And we thank you and praise you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
I don't know if you've noticed, but love's everywhere. Amen. Love's in the air. I mean, it is this time of year. Red and pink hearts are all around. And of course, there's lots of them with slogans on them, things like Be Mine. And that you can see those in advertisements and in the newspaper and in store windows and everything. Amen. And of course, not only are those all around, you know, we just have that feeling in the air. Amen. Can you feel the love? Amen. I hope you can feel the love. Amen. Amen. And of course, being a man, us men, you know, once again, we're being shamed into spending lots of money. You know, if we don't buy flowers for our loved ones, you know, and not only that, but you got to have flowers and candy. And not only that, but you have to have on top of that box of candy, you'd better have something that's got a diamond in it, some kind of jewelry, you know, otherwise you don't really love her. I'm telling you, that just, you know, you got to have a dozen roses and all that kind of thing, amen? Otherwise, hey, I saw this, my daughter made me watch this thing, I couldn't believe it. This young couple, you know, just had been engaged. They just you know, had proposed, and he asked. She said yes. So they went in a jewelry store, and the jewelry store had the cameras running, you know, because of the things. And so they go into the jewelry store, and, you know, the clerk, can I help you? And the fellow says, yes, we'd like to pick out an engagement ring. And the girl, you know, she's looking over the counter, and she's looking and looking. She's, I really like that one. So, of course, the clerk pulls it out and shows it to her. And the fella asks, well, how much is that one? He said, $32,000. I mean, the rock on that thing was incredible. I mean, $32,000. And he's there, whoa, that's way too much. And the girl says, you mean you won't buy that one for me? And he goes, whoa, that's way too much. She said, she says to him, I thought you said you loved me. He says to her, I didn't love you that much. And then she starts crying and runs out of the store. I mean, $32,000 for a ring, you know, but what's that?
That's a pretty cheap lesson.
Yes, it was a cheap lesson. Yeah. Boy. So, you know, I mean, we're under the pressure, aren't we, men, for all of that kind of thing. And, of course, this is what the world calls love. You know, Valentine's Day is coming this week. And so they call it love, and that's, you know, and what God calls love, two different things. Isn't that the truth? You know, what he expects of us and what he puts into a born-again Christian. You know, like we've got here at verse 22 of the passage Brother John read there in Galatians 5, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, and God instills that in us, and it's completely different than what the world calls love. And so, you know, this is what I want to focus in on here. I titled my message, A Valentine Christian, and what we get. And what we're supposed to have, we find here, I'll come back to Galatians in a moment, but in John's Gospel, chapter 13, verse 34 and 35, John's Gospel, chapter 13, verse 34 and 35, we read this, A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. And here we are studying in Sunday school about the precepts of God, that we need to be abiding in the precepts. And here's one of them, that you love one another. That's not too difficult, you know, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. And that's the Valentine Christian. That's what we're striving for. As born-again Christians, we need to be that thing. And so I bring this before you as an example. Now, when we come back here to Galatians chapter 5 and examine it some, I want you to understand that there's and this is still introduction, so don't think this is any of my points yet. I'll get to those. But as far as introduction to this passage goes, there are three truths I want to start with as we examine this. First of all, love in a Christian is a fruit of the Spirit, not the work of the flesh. Love in a Christian is the fruit of the Spirit. We've got written in here, and this is why I had the reading start at verse 13, we're not to, you know, not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. You know, that love is not just, well, I like being around the folks that I go to church with, but we're to serve one another, and that comes from the fruit of the Spirit of the Holy Spirit in us, you know, and then we're to love thy neighbor as thyself, verse 14 of Galatians 5 talks about here. So that's a fruit of the Spirit, not a work of man, because, you know, the work of the flesh here, those are bad things that we see. And, you know, our heart produces, you know, these things if we're not careful, verse 19 through 21. The works of the flesh, these are not love, by the way, are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. And there's a whole lot of things that the world says, a whole lot of ways that the world portrays on the big screen, you know, that these things, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, and lasciviousness, are love. And they're not. They're sin. But the big screen puts them up on there. And it puts it up there. It just puts it up there. And, you know, they're not. And of course, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred varies. I mean, this can come out of us. That's the works of our flesh. And so what we get is a fruit of the Spirit. A second thing that we noticed here is that lost humans cannot manufacture love, godly love, by their efforts. The lost can't have the kind of love that's the fruit of the Spirit. They can't. They just can't do it. Of course, part of that is that they don't know the definition of love, that love is action that purposes the good of another without expecting anything in return. See, the world's love often expects something in return. The world's love doesn't necessarily purpose the good of another, purposes themselves. And some people are in love with love. That's an odd thing. But they can't, by their efforts, ever have godly love in their life. But a born-again Christian can, because we have the Holy Spirit in our life. Amen. But here's a third truth that I want you to just understand as we peruse this. This true love was in Jesus Christ, and when fully in us, will display Christ to the world. This kind of love that we have, when it's fully, you know, it was in Christ, and when we have it, you know, it shows the whole world the Lord Jesus Christ. you know, that's important for us to remember as we take a look at this. By the way, I don't know if any of you realize this, but we get the idea of Valentine's Day from a man that lived. It was about, 457, I think, is when he actually was buried. He was martyred because he didn't follow the dictates that Rome had. But among the Christians in the catacombs and all, and among some of the soldiers that had turned to Christ, he would perform weddings. And apparently at that time, Rome had declared that Roman soldiers couldn't get married. And so anybody who performed a wedding for them, you know, was going against Rome. But not only that, but Valentine was used to cure the blindness of some noblemen. And it was soon before they had arrested him and were going to execute him, which, of course, in those days, they did swiftly. They didn't leave a man on death row for years and years and years. You know, if you were condemned, they executed you quite quickly. And so he knew he was going to be executed, and so he got just a small piece of parchment, and he wrote on there, you know, I'll always remember you, love, Valentine. And that was passed, you know, from servants and got to the girl, love, Valentine. So then they started taking from that point on. And by the way, he was buried on February 14th after his execution. He was executed then and buried. And so from that time on, then people would make little cards and put something on there, and then they would sign it Valentine. And that would just mean that they, you know, their love was for them. So that's where we got that from. I don't know how perfectly true it is, but, you know, Wikipedia says it is, so I have to believe them. Amen. You know, I have to believe them. So I want to explore then this morning, if I can, please, what is this Holy Spirit-produced love? You know, what is this? I mean, this passage talked about love there at verse 13, talked about it in verse 14, and then we come down to verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. And we also have some things in the passage that Brother John wrote that surely don't sound like love. Verse 15, but if you bite and devour one another, that doesn't sound like love. Verse 26, the last of that chapter, let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. That doesn't sound like love. So I want to just try to find out then, you know, this fruit of the Holy Spirit, this love, what are we supposed to have? What is this? What is this love? Well, first of all, and all of these are going to start with, it is something. First thing, it is something not experienced by the unsaved. It is something not experienced by the unsaved. I'll ask you to turn with me to John's Gospel, chapter 5, if you would, and look there at verse 42. John chapter 5, verse 42. And here in Scripture, you know, Jesus has been talking about his relationship with the Father and that kind of thing. And in verse 42, he says this, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. To what he says to them. Here's all these people that are unsaved, and he says this, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. Now, folks, this was said to the religious crowd of Jesus' day. How do I know they're religious? Verse 39, just before that, search the Scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. See, they're willing to search the Scriptures. They're the religious crowd, you know, and they think they have eternal life, but they don't, because they don't have the love of God in them. You see, the unsaved can't experience this kind of love. They were searching the Scriptures not to find God, but to make themselves look good before others. They were trying to bolster their self-righteousness. That's what they were trying to do here. And it led to a disdain of those without piety in their life. So I've searched the Scriptures, and I'm doing all these things, and I'm putting them into practice. And because other people aren't doing that, the uneducated who can't search the Scriptures, they don't know how to read, you know, because they're not doing it, well, then I can look down on them. And that's what they were doing. But that's not the love of God.
Amen.
Amen. It is not the love of God. Now, Jesus said this because they rejected him. Verse 40, and ye will not come to me that ye might have life. They're rejecting him. They're searching the Scriptures. The Scriptures testify of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they reject him. And so then verse 42, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. So this Holy Spirit-produced love is something that the unsaved cannot experience. But secondly, it is something that reaches out to the world. John 3:16. This love that the Holy Spirit puts in us that makes us a Valentine Christian, it reaches out to the world. John 3:16, which we shouldn't have to turn to, we should know it, but John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." What a definition of love. You know, here's action of on God's part. You know, he loved the world and gave his only begotten Son. And it purposes our good, because whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's the ultimate good. The ultimate bad is an eternity in the lake of fire. Brimstone, darkness, wailing, gnashing of teeth. That's the ultimate badness, if you will. The ultimate good is everlasting life in heaven with God Almighty.
Amen.
You know, so God, somebody has said, is the greatest lover, and this is the greatest Valentine, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah? And I believe that. I do believe that. So the Valentine Christian has this divine love that cares about the souls of every man, woman, boy, and girl that they ever come in contact with. I don't know about any of you, but it's hard for me. A lot of times it's hard for me to just walk down the street and see people and not think about where they're going to spend eternity. You know, I go to a restaurant and there's people there. Where are they going to spend eternity? Go to a shopping mall. Here's all these people. Where are they going to spend eternity? Our heart just aches at the thought that they're going to perish. And it's because we have a love in us that comes from the Holy Spirit. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2 tells us how much God loved them. 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 2 tells us this about Jesus Christ. It says this, let me get to it and read it correctly here. "And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." That's why when a person rejects Jesus Christ as Savior, they end up in hell. It's because he's paid the price. He's been the propitiation. They could have it if they would reach out for it. It's available to them. Please, please don't ever think this idea that Jesus only died for a certain chosen few, that he only died for an elect group that God chose before the foundation of the world. No, no, no. He died for all the world.
Amen.
That they could all have salvation. Yes. But they reject him. And that breaks our heart. Amen? It really does break our heart. See, there's a sin problem, and God sent Jesus Christ so that a person who repents and believes in what Jesus Christ did could have their sins removed and washed away, so that their sins, though they be scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And that kind of love reaches out to the world. This love was proven when Jesus suffered on the cross. Can I have you turn a little bit there to the book of Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 9. Hebrews chapter 2 verse number 9, and we read this. It says, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man." You know, he partook of the death they all deserve, but they reject him. He suffered, and that was the love that he had for us. We also need to understand that love was given to us to show others. That kind of love that Jesus Christ had, where he was willing to die for every man, that was given to us. Can I ask you to back up to the book of Romans and chapter 5, verse 5 through 8. Romans chapter 5, 5 through 8. And we read this. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. And see, that's that kind of love that's shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. That's what we have. So what is this kind of love? It's something that is not experienced by the unsaved. It's something that reaches out to the world. But thirdly, it is something that abhors the world system. It is something that abhors the world system. I had you just moments ago in 1 John chapter 2. I'd ask you to go back there, please. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17, the end of this section of it here. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17, where we read these words, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away in the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. You know, this world is not a real place. It's not good for us. The world system here, it's talking about. It's not that we can't appreciate the, you know, waterfalls and the flowers and the birds and, you know, even the snow and you know, we can appreciate the mountains and the valleys and the ocean and, you know, that kind of thing. But the world system is what's being talked about here. Now, we're trying to reach the world for Jesus Christ. That's what we're trying to do, but we're not to become like the world. You see, when we look here in Galatians chapter 5, we see those things that I talked about earlier. But if we bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. That's the way of the world, to bite and devour, to use you and just to make money. You know, and Satan's behind all of that. And of course, the world promotes Satan and his deadly murders that he commits. And we see those things in that fruit of the flesh that we saw earlier, the idolatry, the witchcraft, the hatred, the variance, the emulation, the wrath, the strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. You know, that's the way of the world. That's what they want. They want to get into all of that stuff and have no one tell them it's wrong.
That's right.
And that's why they hate us. That's why they keep passing laws to undo what our country was founded on the Word of God, that said those things are wrong, sinful, even criminal. But they pass the laws to undo all that stuff. And that's the world. We have to be careful we don't become like the world, that we don't adopt all of their words. I mean, some of the things are okay. I think that some of those words, you know, are all right, but there's some things we ought not to adopt. Amen? We just ought not to. And we ought to be careful about those things. We ought not to laugh at all the things the world laughs at. We ought not to. That's how we become like the world. See, the real love of Christ abhors those things. We understand it makes us an enemy of God. And because we do not love this world system, we are not loved by the lost. Amen? You know, the unsaved don't like us. You know, Satan controls this world, and this Satan-controlled world does not like us. In John chapter 15, verse 18 through 21, I would like you to look at that. John chapter 15, verse 18 through 21. We read this, if the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you, Jesus said. If ye were of the world would love his own. There's something wrong if the world loves you as an individual. There's something wrong if the world loves the church that you attend. If the world thinks that it's a great church, there's something wrong with that. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. That part of the world system. So we have to abhor the world system. What is this Holy Spirit-produced love? Fourthly, it is something only shown by sacrifice. It is something only shown by sacrifice. I'd ask you to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 8 and 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 8 and 9. Here's how the Holy Spirit had Paul write this for us. I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. Sacrifice. See, when we really love, we will gladly have a sacrificial spirit for others. We will gladly do those things. There's a whole lot of things that go on in this world, a lot of, you know, marriage breakups and family breakups and all that kind of thing. And the children get hurt over it and get concerned through it. They think their parents didn't love them. And folks, it's not that they love them, it's just they love themselves more than they love the child. Now, they love themselves more than somebody else. They're willing to sacrifice for themselves, but not for somebody else. And that's the day and age that we live in. People will sacrifice if it benefits them, but to sacrifice for somebody else, no, they don't want to do that. Back up, if you would, to Romans chapter 9, verse 1 through 3. Go here to Romans chapter 9, verse 1 through 3, and we read these things. I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. The Apostle Paul is saying here, he's willing to sacrifice his salvation and spend eternity in the lake of fire if it would make his brethren, the Jewish people, come to know Jesus as Savior.
Amen.
Now, folks, to sacrifice a meal to give to somebody who's hungry, you know, that's one thing. To say, okay, I'm going to give up having the whole run of my house. I'm going to give half of the house to some family because they don't have a place to live. A Christian family doesn't have a place. So, all right, we'll shrink down and we'll cubbyhole into this part so they can have this part of the house. But that's a sacrifice, but it's not much. See, a Valentine Christian's willing to give up their salvation. I mean, dear ones, I pray this for Italian people. I pray that they'd come to know, that's my kinsmen according to the flesh are Italians. I pray that for my own flesh and blood family, my mom, my brother and my sisters. I pray that. Lord, I'm willing, I'd be willing if I could. If that's what it would take for me to spend eternity in hell and them go to heaven, I would. We have to understand that that's the kind of love, that's what the Holy Spirit produced love would do in our life. I'd ask you to go with me to 1 John again, but this time chapter 3, start at verse 13 through verse 17. The first epistle of John, chapter 3, verse 13 through verse 17. We read this, "Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto love, unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whosoever hath this world's goods, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion for him, how doth the love of God, how dwelleth the love of God in him?" Lord, it's a sacrificial kind of love. That's what we have to have. We're going to be a Valentine Christian. We have to have that. And dear ones, with this kind of love in us, we have a sure knowledge that we know God's love when we love like that. Well, let me conclude this message if I can. The greatest Valentine ever sent was Jesus Christ.
Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Are you unsaved today, looking in by way of the internet? Accept God's love for you. Repent of your sin. We had that list in the book of Galatians of all kinds of sin that are not going to be among those that come into heaven. They've given those up. They've repented of those things. Are you saved? How do others see the love of Jesus Christ inside of you? Do they see your flesh, or do they see the fruit of the Spirit of love? It's your choice this morning. What kind of a Christian do you want to be? I hope you want to be a Valentine Christian. Let's bow our heads. Amen. For a word of prayer. Ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. Is that love of the Holy Spirit in you the way it should be? It's not something that a lost person can manufacture. It's not something your flesh can manufacture. But you have to yield to it. You have to allow the Holy Spirit to make it grow in you. It's a fruit. Fruit grow. We know that fruit grow on a tree. It isn't one day we go out to the tree and there's no fruit, and the next day we go out there and there's a full-grown apple or a full-grown orange or full-grown peach. It has to grow. The fruit of the Spirit of love growing in you. In a church, to bite and devour one another is not the fruit of the love. It's simple. We're to love our neighbor as ourselves. Do we love one another in here, willing to sacrifice for each other? Do we love one another enough to give up some things so they may have benefit? Are we willing to give up some things so that lost people will come to know Jesus as Savior? That's the kind of fruit of the Spirit. Father, I come before you. I don't know. I have no idea what's been said in the hearts of people that are here today. But Lord, I pray that you would continue to work in our life, that this would be a message that would shape us and change us, make us more useful to you, and make us such that we see the world and its ways and its things and its humor and all that and reject it and abhor it. And that the pleasing of the Father is all that be in our heart. And the love that Jesus Christ had would be in us in such a way that others would see it. Lord God, I come to you, and if somebody that looks in by way of the internet doesn't know Jesus as Savior, would they understand today that their disobedience as a child, their lying, their stealing, even if it was a penny, they're using your name as a swear word, they're looking with lust on another person, their envy, their hatred, their anger, all those things that they have are sinful and separate them from you for all eternity. Would they please cry out to Jesus to save them today? Would they cry out and ask, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, and come into my heart and life and be Lord and Master of me. I'm sorry for my sin. I turn from it. I turn to you, dear Jesus, that when you shed your blood at Calvary and were buried and rose again the third day, that you did that for my sin, to wash it away. Would you please make me clean today? Lord, we need you. Help us. May we be Valentine Christians. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen. Amen. Amen, dear ones. Take your hymn book and turn to 183, and we're going to use this hymn as a hymn of invitation. If God's spoken to you about something, would you take care of it this morning? If those that don't know Jesus as Savior need to be saved, would you do that this morning? 183, let's stand together and sing this as a hymn of invitation.
My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, I've ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
Amen. Love. Amen. Love. Not what the world's got out there. Real love. Amen. Amen. love one another. I love you, dear folks. I really do. Not only do I love you, but I like you. Amen. Praise God. It's a good thing. Brother John, can you close us in prayer, please?
Father, we thank you for the great love that you've shown to mankind through the sacrifice of thy only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Lord, for all the benefits that you rain down upon us that have trusted Jesus Christ as our Savior. And Lord, ultimately, we want to be used of you to show that great love to a lost world. And we thank you, Lord, that you've chosen us to bear that treasure to a world that's dying in thirst, Lord, for the truth. And it's just an amazing thing, Lord, to see what you've done. And, you know, I've felt humbled, Lord, this morning to know that great sacrifice that you've made, and that's available to us to make, Lord, for this world. And I pray, Lord, that we may be a sacrifice that's pleasing to you, Lord, and a sweet savor to you. And I pray, Lord, that you would just fill us, Lord, with thy Holy Spirit, that we may be sacrificed, Lord, that you would be glorified and magnified in our lives, and that others in the world would see it, Lord, and want that great love that you have for each of us. And may we go forth, Lord, rejoicing in that great love that you demonstrated so openly and publicly to mankind in the sacrifice of thy only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Lord, for the resurrection of Jesus Christ after 3 days in the grave, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we thank you, Lord, and praise you for this great message of thy love for all of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen, my dear ones. Lord bless you. Have a good afternoon and lunch, and Lord willing, we'll be back here this afternoon at this point.